Hi there, and thank you for joining me for today's live reading of The Second View, The View From Here Trilogy, Book 2 by Leon Stevens, and this is presented by Itsy Bitsy Book Bits. Prologue. After the earthquake hit, the largest on record for the area, the road to the park was deemed too hazardous to reopen. The landslide and rushing water obliterated most of the trail system and public access areas. Known to be missing was a senior park ranger. All other emergency personnel were able to evacuate the area prior to the quake. This is what my news feed was telling me, verified by the evening anchor on a local TV channel. Hearing my phone vibrate on the kitchen counter, I put down my drink and hurried to grab it. I knew who was calling. She usually texts, but this was definitely too much information to digest. She'd texted earlier telling me to turn on the news, but I was already watching. "Can you believe it?" she said. "It's pretty bizarre. What did we do?" "I don't think we did anything. I sure hope we weren't the cause. I can't see how, at least not purposely." There was nothing there we had broken. Other than boiling water on the table in the village in the other world, we hadn't touched anything that seemed important or messed with any equipment. We did get flicked to safety on the island and watched as the cube allowed the exit to open, then closed. After that, the cube disappeared and we came back to our world. It felt as though we had been away for months, though it had only been a few days, there at least. And here, only a few hours had actually passed. Our experience had forged a friendship between April and me. Now we were friends with a secret. We had decided not to tell anyone. Who would believe us anyway? Over the next few months, geologists scoured the collected data, trying to find any indicator they might have missed that would have helped them predict an event of this size. There was no definite conclusion. The other odd aspect of the quake was that, considering its size, there should have been damage to outlying areas, but only the immediate area around the cave entrance had suffered any damage. Communities within a radius of 100 miles were completely unscathed. After a few more weeks, public interest faded, and there was no longer any mention of the quake in local newspapers or broadcast reports. Chapter 1. I was up early. I always am. Even during the winter, when the sun hasn't risen yet, I try to get in an early morning run of at least 10 miles. This morning was no different, except that I rode my bike for the first time in a week. Getting old sucks. I had tweaked something in my back while I was attempting to rearrange the backyard patio stones. This was the first in a long time that I'd been laid up with an injury, and I was determined that it would be the last. More yoga, more cross training, more weights. The ride had felt good, and I was sitting on my balcony, steaming black coffee in hand when my phone pinged. "I think I found it," was all it said. I wondered what April was doing up at this time. Since our adventure together, exploring the world beyond the cave, we had met up many times, sometimes for a meal out, a drink at the local brew pub, or an early morning ride or run, which was never as early as I would have liked, and too early for her. She found it? April knew people in the geology department at the university and at USGS, so she had been doing some research during her spare time. I, on the other hand, not being as connected or tech savvy, tended to follow her lead and do the small tasks she asked of me, writing down the details of our trip, mapping, and general research. Her theory was that the entrance was tied to the North Magnetic Pole, which had been tracked moving steadily northward since its discovery in the late 1800s. We had mapped the magnetic signature around the collapsed cave with a drone a few weeks back. That area of the park was still closed, but we were able to get close enough to do this during early one spring morning, riding our bikes there when tourist traffic was low. "See," I had said to her when we arrived at the barricade to the trailhead, "there are benefits to rising early. There's benefits to sleeping in, too." I texted her back, "My place or yours?" "Mine." On my way to her place, I contemplated what this would mean. Could we really get back to that world? We had never told anyone of its existence. Who'd believe us? We had no evidence. The entrance had been destroyed, presumably in the earthquake, and honestly, I sometimes doubted it myself. I pulled up to the visitors' parking spot in front of April's condo building, got out, and looked up to the third floor, where I could see her leaning against her balcony railing, wearing a big grin. I waved back and walked into the lobby. I didn't have to press her apartment button as the door was already buzzing. I walked past the elevators and took the stairs two at a time to her floor. April was waiting in the hall. "Are you serious?" I asked as I walked toward her. She smiled and waved the stack of papers she held in her hand. "Yep." We hugged and entered her place. There was a treadmill in the corner looking out across the balcony toward the mountains. A bike on a trainer was right beside it. Uncharacteristically, there were clothes hanging off the bike. I pointed and laughed. April shook her head. Shut up. I was just airing them out. I took off my shoes and headed to the dining room table. Coffee, I hinted. Already on. I sat down. The table was strewn with open notebooks, maps, photographs, and pens. She plopped the paper she was holding down, creating a rush of air that sent several sheets off the edge and floating to the floor. She didn't keep a messy home, but she wasn't the neatest either. I reached down and gathered them up. I'll get the coffee. You look at the data, she said. I flipped through the papers. There were some graphs, maps, and notes written throughout. There was a map with two sets of circles, one along the movement of the pole and the other tied to the cave. I wasn't great at science, but what I derived from what I was seeing was that the cave entrance had the same magnetic signature as the magnetic North Pole did in the mid-1900s. I've mulled this over in my head. I called into the kitchen. So, you believe that since the pole has moved, so has the entrance? I don't believe, Thomas. I know, she replied. Look at the last map. I flipped to the end and scanned the page. A line drawn on the map connected the magnetic North Pole, which was now as close to the geographic pole as it ever has been in recorded history, to a point on the south coast of Alaska. What's there? I asked, much too loudly, as April had entered the room. She was carrying two mugs and placed one beside me. She tapped her finger on a green section of the map. There's a park with a hiking trail that ends at a glacier. You think there's an entrance there? There has to be. There was a small tremor there that day the earthquake occurred. That doesn't prove anything. Tremors and aftershocks happened all the time. But there were none in our area, and I don't think the seismologist made the connection. It was too weak. April moved my mug from in front of me, placing it on a stack of books and rummaged through the pages, stopping to pull out another map. She unfolded it to reveal a map of the Pacific coast, which had red dots indicating tremors along the offshore fault line and through the interior of British Columbia. She traced her finger between the dots, following a dark pencil line until she reached the Alaskan coast. Look, there was no seismic activity between the trailhead where the cave was and this point. Zero. There were a few up the coast and inland, but as you can see, there's a gap. That's extremely unusual in such an active tectonic zone. How many days of data is this? I asked. Only a few. After that, there's a normal distribution of tremors. One door closes and another opens? I asked. Bingo. I took a sip. She makes good coffee. If you are right, I am, she said confidently. Can we get there? I don't think it's a matter of can, but when, I said, chiming in. I looked over the rest of the papers and knew she was onto something. As I drove home, I thought about what this meant. Another adventure. Over the next few weeks, we met regularly to discuss our plans. Sketching out a map of the inner world helped put things in better perspective. There were 21 exits slash entrances around the outside, which corresponded to the 21 buoy lines that pointed to the island. Double that to get to the 42 doors in the center building. We estimated that the island was 20 miles from the cliff, and the trip to the center was about 3. That would make the diameter 46 miles, so the circumference would be 46 times 3.14, 144. Divide that by 21 to get to the distance between the exits around the perimeter, 6.8. That's not too bad. That's 42 miles to Flick's home world and another 28 to the next, I commented. April shook her head. That's traveling along the outside, though. If we head straight to the open entrance, it would be much shorter. If we'd had more time and a quicker means of traveling within that world, it would have been intriguing to visit each outer world, although we were certain that all but two were inaccessible. The changing color of the buoys gave us that theory. Flick's changed color when the door was closed, so only ours and the other remained. We pondered visiting our alien friend Flick's new world. April reminded me she had tried to exit the building using a different door than we entered, without success. We reminisced about our first encounter with Flick, having to develop some form of communication and helping to bring him, they, to their new world, their new home. That's where we figured the door led. Maybe that door stays open now, April asked. The inner or outer? I thought the inner door closed. Did it? I thought for a moment. I don't remember. I think it did. The cube disappeared. Yeah, that's right, but did the door lock? We could try opening it. It would be nice to see Flick again. You just want the warm thank you tickles, April smiled. Don't you? Yeah, I did. We settled on a plan to go to the last remaining outer world that seemed available to us. I thought that, with the boat, It would be interesting to see the other entrance points, but April had a better idea. Should we go to the island to pick some of the food flowers? It would help us extend our time there. You have a point. Going to the island would add distance, but gathering a food supply would be worth the trouble. The next concern was what to bring. That brought up a lot of questions. For instance, would the entrance open into the same cave where we had left our gear? If not, and we came out in a different one, we would need to bring with us all the gear we had taken before, just in case. The biggest question, one we'd been skirting around for months, was why that world and the portals existed at all. We knew Flick's world was headed for destruction. Its moon was on a slowly degrading orbit, at least as far as we were able to ascertain from Flick's drawing. There was an evacuation to the center island leading to some type of escape route. Uneasily, I posed the question to April. So, do you think humans are headed for a catastrophe? Is there any doubt? Look at the climate emergency, the pandemics, all the wars. Flick had a cube that allowed for exiting to a safer place. Does humanity have one? She shrugged. Maybe we haven't found it yet. Where do we look? The cave? April shook her head. I scoured that place before, never found anything. Maybe someone is going to give us one. There was another possibility. We were the evacuees, and our door never closed. Again, we had more questions than answers. Chapter 2. We hoped this new entrance would lead into the same cave where we had left our supplies, but in case it didn't, we needed to outfit ourselves from scratch. The place wasn't going to be easy to get to either. The previous entrance had its challenges, but at least it was close to home. We'd have to travel even lighter, inflatable kayaks instead of a boat and motor. Having to paddle would increase our travel time, so we had to bring more food, and the lighter, the better. This wouldn't be a fine dining experience, that's for sure. Water wasn't a problem. There was plenty of that where we were going. We shipped our gear ahead of time and double-checked that it had arrived safely. When we arranged to rent a boat that would get us to the inlet, as it was more out of the way, it was a hiking destination only for the more adventurous, and we were going during a time when there wouldn't be many visitors. We wanted to keep the secret between us as long as possible. Tickets in hand, we sat in the airport terminal waiting for our Alaska Airlines flight to be announced. I looked through the windows, watching planes arriving and taking off. Do you really think it's there? I mused. I hope so. At least we'll know what to expect. Maybe we should expect the unexpected. I nodded. Yes, that's a good mantra. We were not the only ones trying to travel light. Most passengers had large carry-ons these days or backpacks like we did, and it was a bit of a battle for overhead space. April got the last spot, and I was relegated to stuffing my pack under the seat. You can have my pretzels, April joked, knowing I don't like them. She zipped into the window seat. And my peanuts. Thanks. I was asleep before takeoff and remained so through most of the flight, despite some turbulence. April, not so much. Apparently, I snore at high altitude. We landed in the late afternoon. We grabbed our bags and joined the rest of the passengers shuffling out into the airport terminal. The rental truck was reserved for the next day, so we took a taxi to the hotel. Our rooms were across from each other, and after I showered, I went down to meet April in the lobby. The guy at the front desk directed us to a popular local joint to get a bite to eat. We walked the few blocks in the bright evening sun. The air was different here, cool, fresh. I made sure to make the most of each breath. The restaurant was busy but not crowded, and we got a table by the open street side wall, which was just a long glass door that was retracted to the ceiling to take advantage of the mild evening. Excited? I asked April after we had placed our order. Yeah, it seems new, even though we've been there, done that. Always expect, I started, the unexpected, she finished and raised her glass. I followed her lead. Agreed. Cheers. The microbrew went down nicely, and it was a shame we had to stop at one. In the morning, after a breakfast that was sure to stick to our ribs for a while, your standard diner special of bacon, eggs, toast with sides of oatmeal and coffee, we picked up our truck and drove to the storage lot where we had sent our gear. Kayaks, tents, dehydrated foods, ropes, a duplicate of what we brought the first time. It seemed like overkill, but better safe than sorry. The next stop was for the boat and motor that would get us quickly to the beginning of the trail. It wasn't pretty, with plenty of scratches and dents, so I did my best inspection under the watchful eye of the owner. It doesn't leak, he said. I asked him to take pictures of each side for damage purposes, and he reluctantly agreed. I followed around, taking photos from the same angles. Satisfied? I hooked up the trailer and checked the lights. I had to wiggle the connector a few times to get everything to work. I signed the papers while April ran across the street to get us some coffee. The last stop was to fill up a couple of jerry cans of gas. April said she wanted to drive. I've never driven in Alaska before. So you can cross that off your list? Yep. Did you cross off visiting another world and befriending an alien? She laughed. Driving in Alaska pales in comparison, doesn't it? Traffic was light, and we were outside of town within 5 minutes and away on our next adventure. The mountains soared up on one side of the highway, while the inlet to our right reflected the morning sky. No wind, a few clouds, a perfect day. The destination wasn't far, but despite our enthusiasm to get there, we stopped a few times at some of the overlooks to marvel at the view. The sign indicating the turnoff was smaller than I expected. Maybe it wasn't needed, as people knew about this spot, or maybe this was on purpose to dissuade the annoying tourists. If the sign didn't do that, then the road definitely would. We bounced through a long series of ruts and holes. I kept looking back to make sure the trailer with the boat was still attached. April made a game of trying not to spill her coffee by holding it in her hand and moving it up and down with the motion of the truck. The parking lot was empty. We had planned our early arrival in hopes of that. This was a popular launching point for overnight canoeing and kayaking trips, so we wanted to get a good head start. We put the boat into the glassy water with no difficulty and loaded in the gear. We had been able to get all of it into two large packs, which wasn't easy, but it was necessary to limit our hike to one trip. I asked April for her ID and put hers and mine in the center console. Our money, credit, debit cards, cell phones, and keys went into a Ziploc bag, which I buried out of sight. This was a trick I adopted after getting my car broken into while I was on a week-long hike. The ID in the vehicle was the just-in-case courtesy for identification if we didn't make it back. I checked the door, and as we walked away, April nudged me and pointed back to the truck. On the dashboard was a handwritten note with two words. Nice, I thought.